And it's really a privilege to be part of this seminar. Thank you for inviting me, and it's a super privilege to follow such excellent speakers and incredible organizations that work around the world. So I bring you greetings from Botswana, my home country, and also from the ILC network, which is has members based in about 80 countries around the world. What brings our membership together is a common vision of what our members call people-centered land governance. But this is, I'm glad that several people have used the word people-centered, because I think when we talk about our work for land rights, we need to constantly be protecting the idea that land is for people. Land is not a commodity. Land is not for money. Land is about human dignity and human well-being. And human survival. And so our members have defined people-centered land governance as the land governance which respects Indigenous peoples' territorial rights, which gives equal land rights for women, which allows ecosystems to be managed sustainably and locally, which protects land rights defenders, which does not allow land grabbing. And so this vision, as we contrast it with reality and going back to the summary that Christian gave us at the beginning, we can see very clearly that we're failing, that we're not succeeding to bring about the kind of reforms that we would like to see. And in fact, although many countries have brought about 10-year reforms in the past few decades, the reality is, again, as Christian said in the beginning, land inequality is worse than it has been. In fact, it's been getting worse since the 1980s. So in a report that we put out at the end of last year, the culmination of several years of research, bringing together about 30 different organizations, one of the things we found is that land inequality is actually over 40% worse than we thought it was using traditional statistical methods. The largest 1% of the farms in the world operate more than 70% of the farmland. The bottom 50% of farmers own less than 2% of the land. And the reality is land grabbing is continuing, dispossession is continuing, it's getting worse. And even in these pandemic conditions in which suffering is coming to so many people, we see land grabbers taking advantage of lockdown to do even more land grabbing. And in all of this, the most vulnerable land is the commons, those shared resources that provide a safety net to the poorest in our society, and the most vulnerable people are the people who live on the commons. So I think it's very clear, and every speaker has said that we have a problem, and it's a systemic problem. It's not a surface problem. It's a problem which is we have created by the economic and the social systems that we've created around us. And therefore, as we look to a solution, we need systemic change. And systemic change means power shifts. It means shifting power from those who have it currently, from the political and economic elite, to the women, to the men, and to the communities who live on the land, and to the organizations that represent those women, men, and communities. And I think the most important way of understanding how we can bring about system change was mentioned by Christian in the last point of his slide, was repeated by Rajagopal and was repeated as well by Hortense. All of them referred to alliances, how we create alliances nationally, regionally, and globally that can transform the systems that currently perpetuate inequality and dispossession from land and territory. So if you'd allow, I'd like to share from an ILC perspective, three actions in building these alliances that I think is our contribution as ILC, and that we are working on together with other organizations and agencies beyond our network, that give us a chance of seeing in reality over the next decade people-centered land governance coming to mean better land rights for the women, for the men, for the communities who live on the land and use it. So each of these three thrusts that I'm going to describe really rely on building wide partnerships. We're not going to make progress unless we can build wide partnerships. But it's not only about wide partnerships, it's about building partnerships that are in solidarity with people's organizations. When I say people's organizations, I mean the likes of Via Campesina, the likes of Ekta Parishad, those organizations that belong to the people who live on the land, whether they're women, whether they're farmers, whether they're indigenous peoples, whether they're landless people, whether they are pastoralists, those organizations that belong to them, those are the organizations that need to be taking the lead. And the role of the rest of us is to work together in solidarity, behind and in support of people's organizations. So let me share each of these areas of partnership building that we as ILC will be dedicating ourselves to over the next decade in our strategy, which will take us to 2030. And that I really hope that we'll be working together with many of the kinds of organizations that are on this call to bring into reality. So the first is at the national level and building national coalitions for change. The national level in countries, that's where the change happens. And that's where we need to be building what Raja Gopal referred to as countrywide mass movements for change. And so these are partnerships of like-minded organizations. In the lead are people's organizations. They're rooted in people's organizations, but they bring around them partners that are able to support their agenda. And so work in solidarity with the struggles of local communities for their land. Often these partnerships go beyond people's organizations though. They may include NGO support organizations. They may include research organizations. They may even include government agencies that can identify with and that can become allies in these change agendas. Over the last 6 years, ILC, through such partnerships in 30 countries, has achieved over 83 people-centered policies on laws and land rights. But changing policy is not enough. And we know that so many countries have changed laws and changed policies, but that has not changed anything for the reality of people who live in their communities and on their land. And so as we look ahead, our challenge really is getting these partnerships behind bringing real change, making sure that those policies are implemented on the ground in the communities, which Raja Gopal referred to as the sort of bottom-up community and democracy and state building from the bottom up, not from the top down. And I think all of us have a challenge in supporting this process, in really investing in the leadership of women, that women leaders can be real change makers where they're given the space to be leaders and where their leadership is supported. And unfortunately, many of our organizations don't sufficiently support women leadership. So that's a change that we need to bring in our own organizations as we seek these wider changes in our countries. So the first is building strong, powerful national coalitions that work with a long-term vision for bringing change. The second area is what we call in ILC people-centered data. So data gives the power to open up and to expose and to lay bare realities. It also gives the power to shape those realities. And unfortunately, the reality is that data on land is often missing. Official data sets don't have them. You may know that no countries in the first 5 years of reporting on the SDGs have reported on the land indicators, because for many different reasons, but one of those reasons is many countries don't have that data. And so the lack of progress is hidden. It's not visible. The continued dispossession is not visible because we don't have the numbers to show that. And so we're supporting not just any data, but people-centered data. This is data which is collected, managed, used, and controlled by people's organizations that puts the power of data in the hands of people and allows them to show the reality that they see on the ground and allows them to hold decision makers accountable. Those may be government decision makers, a local government or national government. There may also be corporations, and accountability needs to extend right across all kinds of decision makers, and data is a pathway to doing that. And then thirdly and finally, we need to support these national processes through powerful regional and global partnerships that can advocate for rights to land and can shift norms. I think we've made a lot of success together, and organizations like Via Campesina have really been in the forefront of the recent UN Declaration on the Rights of Peasants. The African Land Policy Framework and Guidelines has been a common effort, the VGGTs. Right now, we're working together as ILC and other organizations, especially Via Campesina, are playing a very strong role in promoting the recognition of the right to land as a human right. We hope that we will be successful together. But these regional and global frameworks are incredibly important in shifting global norms towards a greater acceptance of the importance of land rights. And I think this is important as we look to the decade ahead and we see the great challenges the world is facing, not only emerging from a pandemic, but climate change, but huge and increasing inequality, the erosion of democracy. And underneath all of these issues is land rights. Land rights is central to dealing with climate change. Land rights is central to building democracy. It's central to overcoming inequality. It's central to sustainable and resilient local food systems. But we will have to struggle together to keep it visible and to build commitment, political will and commitment. And just to bring in the same principle again here, as we work together at a regional and global level, we need to work together to be a platform for people's voices. The voices that need to be heard are the voices of the women and the men and the communities, pastoralists, fisher folk, indigenous peoples who live on the land. Those are the voices that need to be heard in these regional and global processes. So let me just conclude by just re-expressing the commitment of ILC to be part of building these partnerships and alliances, and our commitment to build partnerships in a way that complements strong, autonomous people's organizations. Partnerships don't work, they don't bring about change unless alongside those partnerships, in those partnerships, but also alongside those partnerships, are strong voices of land users, are strong social movements that carry the voices of land users into those change processes. And in those partnerships, we have a commitment as well as ILC. As ILC, the leadership role is played by people's organizations and wherever possible, it's played by women. So as we look at the challenges ahead, I hope that we can see the next decade, not only the big challenges we face, but also the possibilities as we bring our different, very diverse strengths together in these common struggles. And in doing so, that we can achieve a more just, equitable, and sustainable world. Back to you, Milun. Thank you so much. Okay.
Thanks very much, Michael.